the Fonda. I didn't realise I've got a middle name. Right, good evening everybody. First and foremost, you're probably all wondering where I'm going. Sadly, it's been a bit under the weather. I'm sure you'll all join. Let's have a round of applause. You may well be watching. Andy Halloran, get well soon. The reason I say that you might be watching is because this event tonight is being shown on the new South Lake City YouTube channel. It's on a Facebook YouTube channel. I'm sure you've all seen it. SBC. So we are going to a global but what that does mean is that when we get Mr. Nottingham Forest on stage, we need to be very, very quiet because we are being shown across the globe tonight. I've got the names of the winners on the silent auction. So Jane McManus, Chris McManus, Mick Ian, Tony Bagley, and you got me shaking, got me running away. You got me crawling up to you every day. Don't bring me down. No. So as I say, a bit of housekeeping. I'll tell you what's wrong before I get off the floor. The first part we're going to talk about is playing career, and then we're going to have a little bit of a break, and when he comes back, we'll go into the managerial side and everything else that followed that. And as we all know, that's chairman, ambassador, and just about every other role at the club that you could possibly do. A couple of events coming up as well that I just need to tell you about. So Friday the 11th of September, there is the Big Forest Quiz. You may have seen it on the screens. So it's £20 a team, and that's a team of four, jointly hosted by myself and Andy. Hopefully he'll be back with us by then. Blooming Dementia and Motor Neurone Disease are the two charities that will benefit from that night. So all proceeds from that evening will go to those two charities. Thursday the 22nd of October, we've also got Dave Bassett joining us. That's the Bassett Blueprint. And he's going to talk us through how he gained promotion. Can you believe that he was the last Forest manager to get us promoted? I know, it's true. Dave Bassett was the last Forest manager to get us promoted to the Premier League. I was just sat over there and somebody said to me, what year was that? 1998. Shall we park that there? I think we better. 1998 was the last time, and obviously 2021 is the next time. Yeah? Here, here, absolutely. Right, without further ado, so I've done a little bit of homework because obviously we're all familiar with this man's career since he came south. But 486 games in all competitions for Newcastle United, that's fourth in their all-time list of appearances. Let's not forget that. And then, of course, he came down here. At a time when we were just an average second division team, a bit like now. Sorry, did I say that out loud? 117 games for Forest, one famous goal at Ipswich that he's going to talk to us about. Manager at Leighton Orient, obviously manager at Forest. Little bit about Manchester City as well when he went there. And then obviously he became our chairman, ambassador. And tonight he's with you guys. Put your hands together for Mr. Frank Clark. Frank, you scared me then. I thought you were just going to jump up there. That's a bit of a jump.
That scared me. I thought I was going to have to jump up there.
You want to grab a seat?
Certainly.
So, Frank, I mentioned earlier that we're going to talk a little bit about your playing career first. And then we'll move on a little bit later to everything that came after that. So born in Rowlands Hill, a borough of Gateshead. Were you in? Was it a sporting family?
Yes and no. Yeah, my father was a very good golfer. You know, he played for his local club, and he was a decent cricketer. My uncle was a decent cricketer. He was also a bit of a ladies' man. I'm not sure that I inherited that from him as well. But no, that was. But I had a few cousins as well who played. Two of my cousins who were a little bit older than me both played for Tow Law Town and played in an Amateur Cup final at Wembley. So I guess there was a little bit of it running in the family, yeah.
And you were Crooktown, weren't you, originally? Is that right?
Well, yeah, that's where I won my first honour, if you like. I was still at school. I stayed at school till I was did my A-levels. There was a bit less fuss about them then than there is today. thank God. And I played for Crook for a year in the Northern League and was lucky enough to get to an Amateur Cup final. Played at Wembley when I was just 18 and still at school. It was quite an experience. We drew at Wembley and then won the replay. So that's where I started, yeah.
How were you discovered? Because, I mean, obviously these days there's academies and you know, kids get sort of, you know, 7, 8-year-olds. How did it work back then?
Well, there was nothing like that. But there was a lot of schools football. Schools football was obviously very strong then. And I played for my school. I played for all the district teams. Got trials for the England schools under 15s. So there were quite a few professional clubs sniffing about, trying to get me to sign. But really, I didn't particularly want to be a professional footballer, believe it or not. Just remember, back in those days, you know, the maximum wage was still on. So you were never going to earn a fortune. And I just kept seeing all these players falling by the wayside, picking up injuries, and their careers being finished. It didn't really appeal to me at all. So I kept turning them all down. The chief scout from Newcastle used to come to my house every Sunday morning for his breakfast. Till my mother got sick of him. And I was playing for my local village team, and we played against Crooktown in the Durham Senior Cup. And we actually knocked them out, which was like a real giant killing. Like, you know, it was almost like Hereford beating Newcastle United. Just thought I'd get that one in before anybody mentions it later on. And we beat them. And listen, this is symptomatic of my career, and I'm not trying to be clever or anything like that. I've been very lucky right through my career. You know, the opportunities have always come around at the right time. And just after that that game against Crook, they had a player, left back, who was an international player called Bert Stewart, played for England, international amateur team. And he got injured and finished, couldn't play again. So they're desperate for a left back, so I must have impressed him when we played against him at Highfield. And I went over there for a season. And we played in the, as I say, we won the amateur Cup final. I played a couple of games for the England amateur team. And the Newcastle scout kept coming and knocking on the door on a Sunday morning. And eventually, in the November of 62, they got me. I still didn't want to convinced about being a full-time pro, so they got me a job in the Royal Victoria Infirmary in Newcastle. And I worked there in the biochemistry department. And I trained two nights a week and played part-time in Newcastle Reserves. And that came to a grisly end. I came across somebody called Tommy Smith. And I remember very clearly a reserve team game at Liverpool Reserves and Newcastle Reserves. I was just trying to establish myself in the team. Tommy was about the same age. He was just coming through. And I didn't see him coming, really. And I ended up in hospital. Broken leg. Both bones, and I was out for 11 months.
What age was that, Frank? What?
I was 19 then. I was 19. Treatment was much more conservative in those days. I wasn't allowed to get out of bed for 6 weeks at all. And then I had a full-length plaster on for another 16 weeks So you can imagine what sort of state my muscles were in by the end of all that. And I was out for 11 months. And the professor, I was off work for quite a bit, obviously. And the professor in the hospital who was running everything said, you're going to have to make a decision whether you're going to be a footballer or whether you're going to be a lab technician. And I looked at the guy who was running the lab at the RVI. Top man had been there 30 years and he was earning about 15 quid a week. And I thought, man, not for me, this like. And by that time, I had a fair idea. I'd got over the break. I had a fair idea that I might make it as a footballer, so I decided to go full-time at Newcastle.
And Newcastle's manager at that time, Joe Harvey, what sort of style of play was that? Did that sort of suit you, or...?
Well, the style of play in those days suited me because fullbacks never crossed the halfway line. And I'm sure all you lot have seen me play for Nottingham Forest realise, well, that's the best place for you, really. That's how it used to be, you know. Fullbacks stayed in the centre-half, stayed at the back, and...
Is that why it was 486 games and no goals?
Because
exactly, you never went anywhere near it.
Well, it wasn't. You see that if people look up on Wikipedia, you know, and it's never quite right there, like, you know. I did actually score two goals for Newcastle. One in that very, very important competition called the Texaco Cup, and another one in the League Cup. We played Doncaster in the League Cup, and I'd gone about 7 years or something without 8 years without scoring. And we played Doncaster in the League Cup, and we beat them 6-0 at St James's Park, and I scored the sixth goal. And the crowd invaded the pitch.
we're going to come on to that in a bit, because
I'm sure
Tony Beecroft's going to kill me if we don't mention crowds.
I'm sure we'll come back to that, yeah. The crowd invaded the pitch. It was crazy, really. The players went berserk. We had champagne in the dressing room, all that kind of rubbish. I was embarrassed, really. And I met some of the Doncaster players a few years later. In fact, Terry Curran was playing that night, and he came to play for us at Forest. He said, what was going on that night? He said, when the sixth goal went in and the crowd went berserk, we couldn't believe it. I said, Terry, that was my first ever goal. Like, you know.
But not your last, which we'll
not
come
last,
we'll
no.
come on to,
we'll come, to that one,
we'll
yeah.
come on to in a bit. So you said a little bit tongue-in-cheek there about the Texaco Cup. I was looking earlier, and we're actually sat tonight with one of Newcastle United's most decorated footballers ever. Because we talked about the fact that Forest haven't been in the Premier League since 1999. Newcastle's last major honour, believe it or not, was the Fairs Cup in 69, which was the...
Yes, it was. We were in the second division when I went there. Not a very good team, really. Club in a bit of a state. My first full season in the team, we got promoted. We won the second division championship and got promoted. And we managed, with a struggle, to kind of semi-establish ourselves in the old first division, mid-table. Never quite good enough to move up to the top, but, you know, surviving all right. And in the 68-69 season, the most incredible thing happened. This was the Fairs Cup, was called the Intercity Fairs Cup. It was a forerunner of what is now called the Europa League. And they had this silly rule, didn't think it was silly at the time, but with the benefit of hindsight, that there could only be one club from one city played in it. So at the end of the 67-68 season, Manchester City had won the first division. So they were playing in the European Cup. Manchester United, who finished second in the first division, won the European Cup, if you remember, in 68. So they could play again next season. There were three London teams finished fourth, fifth, and sixth, but only one of them could go in the Fairs Cup. Liverpool and Everton finished eighth and ninth or something, but only one of them could play in the Fairs Cup. We finished 10th. We actually finished 10th and sneaked into the Fairs Cup. I was on holiday when somebody told me. I couldn't believe it. I had no idea, you know, about the rules and regulations. And we got absolutely slaughtered by the media, the national media. You know, this is a disgrace. They'll shame English football and all that sort of thing. And we only went on and won it. It was amazing.
Well, that must have been quite a time for Newcastle, because as you say there, when you first started, you were mid-table second division, which we can all relate to. And then second division champions... And you know, again, I mentioned the Texaco Cup. I'm not sure what that was, the Texaco Cup, but you won it twice.
We did, yeah.
What was it? Well, does anybody know?
It was just like a knockout cup. I think it was a forerunner of before they had the League Cup, like, you know. It was just a, let's get some more fixtures in and screw the supporters for some more money and, you know, and have another competition. So we won the Texaco Cup twice. We won the Anglo-Italian
Cup, yeah.
We won the Anglo-Scottish. And by the way, we won the Anglo-Scottish here.
And that was Cluffy's first trophy.
Well, remind me of that. We'll come back to that later on. And whilst they were fairly insignificant competitions, I'm telling you, it did wonders for the morale of the group of players. Because for a lot of them, those trophies were the first trophies that they'd ever won. And the Anglo-Italian was a great competition. You know, we used to go out to Italy and play against Italian teams, and then they would come over and we would play them. And it was a terrific competition.
When I was introducing you onto stage, obviously I introduced you as Mr. Nottingham Forest. There must be, as a young boy growing up in the boroughs of Newcastle, and then playing for your boyhood team for 10 seasons, there's got to be a lot of love for the Geordies.
Well, listen, it was a fantastic time. I mean, being a professional footballer was a wonderful way to earn a living, like, you know. The games themselves weren't very enjoyable. It was too important, you know. We had to win. Once you're a professional, you've got to win. And when I hear these people saying, yeah, we just go out and enjoy it, I'm thinking, oh, what are you talking about, like, you know? You had to win it. But the life was fantastic. And for me, being in Newcastle, I mean, I was always a Newcastle supporter, and playing in a team that went on to win a European competition, got to a cup final, and then were crap at Wembley. But nevertheless, we got there. It was a great, wonderful time for me.
My next question is totally unfair and cruel, given where we are and the room that we're in.
I can see it coming.
But yeah, it's coming. So, allegiances. Should we be playing we being, obviously, the world's best football club, if we were to play against Newcastle United, where are the allegiances?
Oh, I'd want Forest to win, you know.
He's not just saying that.
No. I know what you're going to get to. You're going to get to the FA Cup fifth round, fourth, fifth, sixth round, whatever, like, you know. And I've got to say, and I'm not just saying this because I came to Forest, because if you get a newspaper back from that era, you will see that I was quoted as saying that it was an absolute disgrace what the FA did to Nottingham Forest after that game. An absolute, typical of the FA, but a disgrace. Because if they had kicked us out of the competition, they could have nipped pitch invasions in the bud straight away. Because there's no doubt that, thank you, there's no doubt that the pitch invasion affected the result, like, you know. We were 3-1 down with 10 men, and we were out, you know. And some of the Forest lads, you know, I mean, I've spoken to some of them since, obviously, they were quite, you know, they were upset by the pitch invasion, quite rightly. Like,
we're not very good at forgetting, are we, down here in Nottingham? I don't think it will ever be forgotten by the Forest fans.
Well, quite right, and it's just inconceivable what they did. To make you replay in the first place is crazy, but then to say, well, you've got to go to Everton, and then we have a draw at Everton, and then you've got to go back to Everton. Where's the logic in that, you know? And it's kind of typical of the FA. I mean, it was pathetic, really absolutely pathetic. And we should have been kicked out, no doubt about that. Anyway, we got our comeuppance in the final, you know. We got to the final and played Liverpool, and we were rubbish on the day, like, you know. We were well beaten.
I had the pleasure
but
of...
I didn't make it right, obviously.
I don't get up to Newcastle very often. I had the pleasure of going, I think it was about 5 years ago, one of my mates has got a season ticket there and his dad couldn't go. Do you want to come? Who are they playing? Chelsea. Yeah, I'll have a bit of that. I saw something completely different, and this is no disrespect to any Forest fan, because I'm one, have been since that big. But they're mad up there, aren't they? It's like a religion, isn't it? I mean, we're passionate, but they take it to that next level, don't they?
Yeah, listen, it's a one-club town. That makes a difference straight away, you know. It's a big city, and Yeah, they're starved of success. Like, you know, they're getting more desperate by the year, you know.
I'll tell you the one thing that amazed me the most was the strippers still on in the bars around the ground, aren't they, on the match day? But you might not know about that.
No, I never saw them. Nothing to do with them.
Obviously, I walked straight past them.
Oh, your wife's in here. I'm sure
yeah, no, she is. She's
I'm
over sure there. Yeah, so just need to be careful. No, we did. We went straight to the game. So players that you played with at that time, obviously we're going to talk a little bit about the players that you played with when you came here in a little while. But who were the big names then? I've got a couple of names down. Bobby Moncur, Brian Pop Robson.
Yeah, Bobby was club captain most of the time I was there. He'd been there as a young boy from 15. Came down from Scotland with a great captain and a decent player, good player. Pop Robson, how he never got capped for England, I'll never understand. Although, I don't know, him and I played for Alf Ramsey one night. After we'd won the First Cup in 69, it must have clicked with a few people that, hey, maybe I could play a bit like, you know. Because I used to get terrible stick from the crowd up there. Unbelievable, honestly. And after we won the First Cup, that died down. And Brian Robson and I actually got picked by Alf Ramsey for a Football League 11 to play against the League of Ireland at Barnsley. And I think it was an unofficial trial for the 70 World Cup, because Benetti was in the team, Paul Madeley, Norman Hunter, Francis Lee, Mike Summerby, Johnny Morrissey, Colin Harvey, all people like that who were on the fringes of the England 40 for the World Cup. Anyway, Brian and I must have impressed him very much, because we never heard of it again, like, you know. But I was astounded. I mean, he was a consistent goal scorer for 7-8 seasons with Newcastle and West Ham, and never got a sniff of an England cap. Malcolm MacDonald was a great, great striker. Big mouth, big personality. Came with a big mouth, but backed it up.
Do I remember him scoring 5 against Arsenal in one game?
He scored 5 for England against Cyprus.
5 for England against Cyprus. It was something like, I'm not as old as I look.
Which wasn't hard. Like, I think I might have scored against Cyprus. Well, maybe not. Cyprus aren't that bad. Like, no. He came up. We signed him from Luton, and he came up in a Rolls Royce to sign, you know, and we're all thinking, oh, yeah, this flash cockney bastard coming up here, like, you know. First home game against Liverpool, he scored a hat-trick, didn't he? If you do it, you can have a big mouth, like, you know, but you've got to back it up. But he was fantastic, and him and I became very, very good friends. But the best player I played with in all my time up there was Tony Green. Scottish inside forward, we signed from Blackpool, and he only played for one season at Newcastle. And he was fantastic. We played against Santos in Hong Kong, Pele's team, and Pele played. And Tony Green almost outshone him, like, you know. Almost, not quite. Pele scored a hat-trick and then went off after an hour.
So I guess I don't need to ask you who the best player you played against was.
He was, yeah. But I did get I've got a picture at home, one tackle I did get on him, like, you know.
So you talked about when you were playing for Newcastle not being a fan's favourite. What's it like when you go out to play there and you know that you've got... Because you must hear all that. You know, I talked to some of the Forest players and they can hear it. They know what's going on.
Yeah, you can hear it. You've got to try and dismiss it, you know. You've got to say to yourself, well, the manager must think I can play because he keeps picking me. If I'd sat down really and tried to contextualise it, it would have driven me mad, because... You know, there's this great misconception about supporters. They love their own young players coming through, like, you know. Well, sometimes they do and sometimes they don't, like, you know. But I was a local lad. We were doing all right. And I used to get terrible stick. And I couldn't understand it. I was a nice bloke, I think. I used to do more community work for the football club than anybody else in the club, line, you know. And yet I still got this terrible stick, really. And you either live with it or you die, you go under. and I just I was able to just ignore it, like, you know. Never reacted. And eventually I won them over. After we won the first cup in 69, it changed like that, you know. And when I came here, it was completely different. For some reason, I can't explain it really. I'm still the same player. Even in the second division, when we weren't a particularly good team, you know, I never got any stick from the crowd. I once got a standing ovation here for kicking a ball off the line as it was going in the net. I couldn't believe it. Amazing, you know. So no, I thought it was lovely. We'll get to that later on.
Yeah, I was going to say we'll talk about it a little bit later on. But you had the I was going to say pleasure. Then you had the. Well, let's go with the word pleasure. You had the pleasure of being at the City Ground for the behind closed doors games recently. How do you think that affected the players? Because I mean, we'll talk about what happened in a bit. But how do you think that must have affected? I know it was the same for everybody. But how do you think that affected the guys?
I honestly don't know the answer to that. The way we played, unfortunately, and the results that we got, I think it worked in our favour. I think had we been playing like that in front of our own great support, the crowd would have turned against them. We put some really poor performances in, like, you know. We'll get to the, I know where you're going to get to eventually, but we played some really poor games, like, you know. And if the crowd aren't there and they're not getting on your back, then listen, big clubs, and Forest is, it's a big club, really. You have to have big men in your team. Because it's great when you're winning and you've got 30,000 supporters behind you, like, you know. In Newcastle, you're winning 50,000 behind you, you know. Like Tottenham, Liverpool, you know. When you're not winning, those supporters can make it very difficult. And I'm not criticizing them. That's how it is, like, you know. Because they expect you to win, you know. And they can make it very difficult. And you need big personalities to deal with it. That's what killed me at Manchester City, but we'll get to that later on. If they turn against you, it's not everybody can deal with that. And we put some really poor performances in.
So we'll come to that again a little bit later on. So 10 years at Newcastle, nearly 500 games in all competitions. As I said earlier, one of the most decorated players in terms of trophies won. Can I be honest and say, coming towards the end of your career? Is that...
Well, some people thought I was. I think they must have done. It's a story to it, really, and it... Well, in the... Where are we? 74, 75. In the January 75... I'd been in the team a little bit. Alan Kennedy was coming through as a very, very good prospect at left back. And I'd had one or two injuries. And in the January, I got a phone call from an old footballer called Wally Barnes. One or two of the really old fellas in here, you might remember him. And he was scouting for a club in America called San Jose Earthquakes. And it was when the MLS was like first starting, like, you know. And he came on the phone and he said, would you fancy playing for San Jose Earthquakes in the summer in America? And I thought, oh, sounds quite a good idea, that. I mean, I was in and out of the team. I was married, but we only had one little girl, about two, three, so there was nothing to stop us going, you know. Great opportunity. So I went to see the manager at Newcastle, Joe Harvey, because I had a good relationship with him. I certainly wouldn't want to, you know, talk to him about it. And he said, well, let's go and see the chairman, Lord Westwood, one-eyed Bill. So we go and see Lord Westwood, and he says, you're not going anywhere. Your future is at this football club for a number of years yet. We want you to stay here. Fine. That's what I want to hear. I'm happy to hear that. That's okay. Terrific. This is in January. April the 23rd, 24th, 25th, last game of the season, home to Birmingham. I'm in the team. I play left back. We lose 2-1. In the dressing room after the game, and as usual, I'm the last one out. I always liked to sit and talk to Keith Bergenshaw, who was the first team coach. So him and I are sitting in the dressing room talking, and the manager comes in, Joe Harvey. Fucking face, chin on the floor. He says, I've got some bad news for you, fellas. Oh, yeah. We've all been sacked. And what he meant was, I'd been given a free transfer. He'd been moved upstairs. And Keith Bergenshaw had been sacked as first team coach. Right out of the blue. Okay, I'm absolutely devastated. So I drive home. And my wife, who you've all met, you know what she's like, was putting up the curtains in our brand new home in Whitley Bay. And I walked in and I said, I hope they're not fucking permanent. And she said, what do you mean? So I had to tell her, like, we're off here, you know? And it was a real blow. I mean, I used to get nervous when I crossed the Tyne Bridge, like, you know? And it was a real, real blow. And a couple of journalists up there who I knew had said to me, yeah, don't worry about it, you'll be all right, you'll be loads of clubs after you, like with your record, you know. After a month, I'd had two offers, one at Hartlepool, United, and one at Doncaster Rovers, who were then in the fourth division, and who were managed by Stan Anderson, who was a very, very good friend of mine. So the offers weren't exactly pouring in, like, you know. Fortunately, somebody, a journalist who from the Northeast who knew Brian very well, Brian Clough, had told Brian that I was getting a free transfer because the club tried to keep it quiet. There was none of this thing of putting the list out and it's all over the internet and everybody knows what's happening. Like, Newcastle were trying to keep it quiet. And so he rang Brian and he said, Tom, so I get a call from Brian. So I thought, oh, fantastic, like, you know. Because I knew Brian briefly. I actually played in his testimonial at Sunderland when he had to finish. And I arranged to meet him at the Scotch Corner Hotel. And as luck would have it, I set off driving and I've got a brand new Triumph Stag. Can you remember the Triumph Stag? I thought I was the right dog's bollocks, like, you know. Set off in this Triumph Stag. It breaks down in the Tyne Tunnel. So I'm thinking, Christ, because there's no mobile phones in those days. Anyway, I managed to get in touch with my wife, who then rings Brian and explains it to him. And believe it or believe it not, he actually waited an hour and a half for me. And that was the only time he ever waited for me, like, you know. So I got to the Scotch Corner, and I'd been turning it over in my mind what sort of contract I was going to ask for. I'm thinking, like 500 games. I'm going to be really able to cash in here, you know. So I walked in and he said, all right, now then. He said, two things. He said, I'm only signing you because, A, you can play left back and we haven't got another left back in the club, and, B, you're cheap. Fuck. That was the end of the negotiations. Yeah.
So carry on. So what happened then?
Well, I signed.
Because he wouldn't let you not sign.
I signed. Yeah. We drove down to Nottingham, my wife and my daughter, and we stayed in Hilly's Hotel, the Forest Hills, and I agreed to sign, and this is typical of one of Brian Clough's. We drove back home to Newcastle. And we stopped at the services halfway up between Nottingham and Newcastle. And Brian had gotten, you must have known the manager there, he got on the phone and we went in for a coffee and the manager came over with some cuddly toys and that for my daughter, like, you know, from Brian Clough. Great man management, that, like, you know.
So we all know what happened next, so we'll come on to that. But at the time, so this is this May by this stage? 75?
75, yeah.
Yeah, and obviously there's the players, some of the players still at the club, or already at the club, I should say, like Ian Bowyer, Tony Woodcock, John O'Hare, John McGovern, Viv Anderson, all already at the club with no idea what's around the corner. When did you first feel that something could happen?
Oh, not for a long time. I mean, obviously I knew Brian by reputation. I just felt that the first year I was there, he wasn't really firing on all cylinders.
This was pre-Peter Taylor.
Before Peter came, yeah. I thought we were a very ordinary team. I'm not being disrespectful there. If you look at where we finished in the league, I don't know, eighth or ninth in the old second division. Very ordinary team. We had some decent players there, the ones you've mentioned. But we weren't really tearing up any trees, like, you know. And then he brought Peter Taylor in. And if he hadn't done anything else, Peter Taylor rejuvenated wouldn't be the right word. Electrified might be the best word. He electrified a little fat left winger who became arguably one of the greatest players for us have ever had, like, you know.
I don't think it's an argument, is it? I think...
Well, Ian Story Moore could give you a good argument.
Absolutely.
And John himself would be
And
happy
Stan Collymore will come on to it for the younger ones amongst us. Stan Collymore might be in there as well.
Yeah, I mean, John was... When I first came to the club, I thought John Robertson was a tramp.
John Robertson did.
He had a terrible attitude to training. He obviously didn't dress very well, which had never changed. And him and Jimmy McCann were big mates, and I used to think you two have got no chance, like, you know. But he played a few games, and as I say, we stumbled along that first season, and then Peter came in, and it was all he transformed everybody really, because he transformed Brian. You know, Brian became what he really was, you know, and John O'Hare and John McGovern would explain that better to you, because they'd obviously known him from way back, you know. And the first pre-season when Peter was there, we used to go to a place called Augsburg in Germany, just outside Munich, for a couple of weeks of pre-season training and play a few games against local amateur teams, more of a fitness thing than anything else. And probably in the first week we went training one day, and we gathered in a group, like, and Peter and Brian, and Peter said to Robbo, "You back off back to the hotel, I'll speak to you later on." And Robbo tells the story now, he absolutely, he was shaking. He went back to the hotel, and we did the training session, and Peter and Brian went back, and Peter got laced into him. Excuse me, and this is the strength of them. Then they said to him, "We're only doing this because we think you can play." And nobody ever said that to him. "We're doing this because we think you can play."
Yeah, they were right, weren't they?
And of course you're right. Yeah,
absolutely.
And John took that and thought, well, if they think I can play, maybe I can. And they told him something that, I mean, listen, there's a lot of bollocks talked about coaching, you know. And I mean, I've done all the courses myself, but all his life, John had been told by coaches, play the ball early. When you get it, play it early. Play it off early. Brian Clough said, "You play what you see, son. Get that ball. If you want to run with it, run with it." Transformed him, you know. Transformed him.
And you've talked about the best players you played with when you were at Newcastle. So I think we're talking about probably the best one you played with when you were at Forest. Who else sort of came in around that time that made you think that, yes, we can do something as a team now? Yeah, at Forest.
Well,
yeah.
The thing about Robbo, why I love Robbo so much, Robbo was great for me, like, the perfect man to be there in front of me. Because John always wanted the ball. Even when things were going badly, and he used to get booed sometimes by the punters, even when things were going badly, he would always want the ball. And my job was to get him to him as early as possible. And that suited me down to the ground. The fucking sooner I could get rid of it, the better. Line. So I used to go, boop, there you are, and get on with it. And he was fantastic for me. He will tell you, I was good for him. Because he was never a tackler, and I certainly would never have tried to turn him into a tackler. But I used to get him into good defensive positions when we weren't, when we'd lost the ball, like, you know. So that helped him a little bit, but obviously it was his talent that you know, that took him to where it took him, if you like, you know.
I've had the pleasure of meeting John over the years since I started working at Forest, and the one thing that he always says out of all the achievements during that time, the European Cups and all that sort of stuff, he categorically says that the best achievement at that time was the 42 game unbeaten league run. Would you agree with that?
No. Well, listen, magnificent. It was a magnificent run. No doubt about that. But I watched quite a few of those games. I didn't play. I wasn't a regular first team choice by then. Probably the last 12, I bet if you look and check, I bet 8 of them were drawn. We got to a stage where we were going out not wanting to lose that unbeaten record, and it was affecting how we played. Magnificent achievement, nevertheless. But the most fantastic achievement was the two European Cups.
Yeah.
You cannot, for a club like Forest and the players that they had, win those two European Cups was a fantastic achievement.
So that 42-game unbeaten run became a topic in the dressing room. You were actually conscious of it?
They didn't talk about it, but I could see it.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm out of it a little bit. I was always amongst it. We only had a squad of about 16 players then, you know. I have to smile when I see that the club's now being restricted to 25 players in the first team squad. We had 16. Played in the season, we won the first European Cup. We played 71 games. Won the League Cup, the European Cup, and chased Liverpool all the way to the end of the season to finish runners-up with 16 players. I think that was Cluffy's greatest ever season. Incredible achievement. Some of those games were friendlies. But there were no friendlies with Brian Clough. There were no friendlies with Brian Clough. They all had to be played properly. I remember we went to Tel Aviv to play an Israeli select 11. And I was just on the bench. I didn't play. And we smashed them 6-0. We absolutely smashed them. The lads were fantastic. And the whole stadium at the end of the game stood up and applauded our players off the pitch. And I pulled one of the Israeli lads and I said, what's that about that? We've just hammered you, like, you know. He says, you're the first team that's ever been here and played the game properly. And that was Brian Clough. Remember, we played Mansfield Town in the County Cup Final at Mansfield. I think it was not long before we played in the European Cup Final. And he wasn't there, like. Or we thought he wasn't there. And the first half, we were crap. We were rubbish. I think it was 0-0 at half-time, Mike. I mean, we didn't think he was there. He came in. He came in at half-time. He went absolutely berserk. Like, I mean, I'm not kidding. So there were no friendlies. John Robertson played every game. 71 games.
Every minute as well. Never took him off either, did he?
Every minute of every game.
So just before the European Cup final, the first team turn out at Mansfield in the County Cup final.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Astounding. Yeah. But that was him, you know.
So let's go back to the European Cups and the and let's talk a little bit about Liverpool, because obviously at that time, as they are now, unfortunately, Liverpool are back up there at the top. Sorry, we've not got any Scousers in, have we? No, that's all right. First round draw, first European Cup campaign, and we get drawn against the English champions.
Nightmare, isn't it?
The European Cup winners, I should say, because we were the English champions.
Nightmare. Yeah. All the lads have been checking their passports, see where we're going with the first game in the European Cup, and it's bloody Liverpool. And we're thinking, oh, Christ. And, as you say, they're the European champions, you know, so we weren't actually over the moon with it.
It was never in doubt, though, was it, after the win at the City Ground? When they battered us in the second leg.
I don't think it was. But I didn't play in that. I wasn't even in the squad, believe it or not. That night at the City Ground, Colin had got into left back when I got injured and cemented his place, really. He was doing terrific. And I wasn't even in the squad. I remember I watched it from the stand and I went home and I said to Palm, I said, that's it, I'm off, I'm going. And believe it or not, I nearly went this first team coach to Derby. Two friends of mine were running Derby at the time, Colin Murphy and Dario Grady, and they weren't having a very good time. And if you, I don't know whether you know those two, but neither of them had ever played the game professionally. And they just thought that having me there would give them a little bit of credibility, if you like.
That was a lucky escape then, Frank, wasn't it?
It was a lucky escape, yeah. Lucky for me, again. Lucky for me again, but a terrible, terrible blow for Colin Barrett. Because Colin Barrett was an unsung hero. He came to Forest as a utility player, really. He could play centre back, played right back, he played in midfield, but he never played left back. And I got injured against Arsenal away. I was just sprinting past Malcolm McDonald. No, don't laugh. When my hamstring went, and Colin came in, and he'd never played before at left back. Was terrific. Made the position his own, really. And then he has his glory night against Liverpool, where he scores that fantastic second goal, which was the most important goal, because that really changed the whole balance of the tie. And the following week, before the second leg, he got a career-shattering injury. And although he played again, he was never ever the same, you know. So, as I say, I wasn't in the team for the first leg. The second leg away, that was my first team game of the season. Liverpool away. Fucking hell, it was like the Alamo.
Yeah, they were good that night, weren't they?
Well, they'd obviously said, look, this old bugger hasn't played all season. Like, you know, we've got to
ping it down that wing.
That suited me down the ground. I was all right with that. And they couldn't beat us, could they? They were a great team, but for two seasons, they just couldn't find a way to beat us, you know.
You mentioned earlier that you wanted me to come back to the Anglo-Italian Cup, so this is probably a good time.
Well, Brian would tell you this himself, and all the lads. We won the Anglo-Scottish Cup at Forest.
I meant Anglo-Scottish Cup,
We
sorry.
Won the Anglo-Scottish Cup, I think it was the second season I was here. We actually beat Leighton Orient in the final. And whilst it was a very minor competition, I'm telling you, and you can speak to some of the lads now, and they'll admit this, it was a big, big step on the way to us becoming a good team. Because it was the first thing we'd won as a group of players, and the first thing a lot of them had ever won in their careers. And it just gave everybody that kind of sense of belief that we could perhaps go players as a group, you know.
So talk us through... We mentioned it earlier, and I do apologise for thinking that you didn't score for Newcastle. Talk us through that moment at Ipswich, because am I right in thinking that we'd already secured the league title, and then we go down there, Paul Mariner?
Paul Mariner, yep. I've got to put this in context, because I wouldn't want to blow my own trumpet like that. We've won the league on the Saturday with a draw, a scrappy 0-0 draw against Coventry. And our next game is Tuesday night away to Ipswich. Now, Ipswich are playing in the cup final 10 days later. Our lads have been on the piss for 3 days since we beat Coventry.
Since the Coventry draw,
to win the title. So you can imagine, on the night, I'm the sub. In those days, there was only one sub. And I'm it on the bench. And the first half is absolute crap, honestly. It is rubbish. And they all come in, it's 0-0. And Cluffy goes absolutely berserk. Like. I mean, he just went off on it. Like. Now, we had a centre forward in those days called Peter With. Terrific player, great team man, not the brightest shilling in the box. Peter bites back at him, doesn't he? Everybody else is... sitting looking at the floor. Peter bites back, and Cluffy says, and you, get in the fucking bath. Points to me, get warmed up. So Willie goes in the box, and I'm stood there, like, and I'm trying not to be self-conscious, and I'm warming up, like, and I'm thinking, where am I going to play? And I'm looking at the team, And that night, I think Ian Bomber was playing left back. Now, Bomber's played all over the place. He could play anywhere, like, you know. So I'm thinking, well, you stick Bomber up the front, tell me to go and play left back, like. Anyway, I'm warming up, and the bell goes. He still ain't said anything. I said, boss, where do you want me to play? He says, fucking go and play up front. He said, you can't do any worse than him. And Lloydie burst out laughing. Lloydie was killing himself, like. So anyway, we go out, and after about 5 minutes, I'm looking around, and Ipswich had a big centre-half called Alan Hunter. Remember him? Man Mountain he was. But I knew him because his cousin was Willie McFall, who I'd played with at Newcastle. So I knew Alan fairly well. So first chance I get, I sidled up to him. I said, Alan, you playing in that cup final in 10 days' time? Yeah, I'm not really looking forward to it. I said, well, listen, you fucking keep away from me and I won't come near you either, like, you know. So anyway, we get a corner. Now, we get a corner and I'm standing in the penalty area, Ipswich's penalty area, and I'm embarrassed because I don't know where to stand. I've never been there before. I've never been that close to anybody's goal before. And we never did practice corners at Nottingham Forest. It was all off the cuff line. So I'm sort of kind of standing in the 6-yard box, trying not to look embarrassed. Robbo flips a corner in, and I drops right in my feet 4 yards out. I'm deadly from 4 yards, like. I smash it in the net. The players are all up, running all over the place. Cluffy and Taylor off the bench, giving it all like that. And the punters double comedy, what's happening, you know? And after the game, Peter Taylor went to see Bobby Robson. Bobby Robson was the manager, to get me the match ball. And Bobby wouldn't give it to him. He wouldn't believe I'd played nearly 500 games and not scored a goal. And let me tell you, if everybody who said they were there was there that night, it was Ipswich's best crowd for the last 100 years.
So, Frank, let's finish the first half on the 1979 European Cup final. So what memories have you got from that night?
Well, you know, my luck was in again, you know. I'm talking about how I was always lucky. Like, I always kept dropping into teams for cup finals, you know, because somebody was injured. Like the League Cup, the two League Cup finals, I managed to play in both of them. And we go for the final in Germany, and there are three of us vying for one place, and everybody knows this because Trevor's going to play. Trevor Francis, this is the first European game he's been eligible for since they bought him. He is going to play. So there's me, Martin O'Neill, and Archie Gemmell, who have all been injured leading up to the final. So, like, we've got Archie Gemmell, Scottish international, Martin O'Neill, Irish international, and me. And we know there's only one of us going to play. So he's not said anything. Morning of the game, we do a little training session, not much. And he's walking around, and he walks up to me. He said, "You all right? You fit?" "Yes, boss." "Yeah, I'm fit." Walks up to Archie. "You fit?" Yeah, boss, I'm okay." Walks up to Martin. Martin says the same thing. So we're all fit. Finish the training session. And I'm thinking, I don't know what he's going to do here. Because, like, Bomber was in the squad again. So Bomber could play left back. Archie could play in midfield. Bomber could play left back. Martin could play in midfield. Or Ian could play in midfield. And I would play left back. And he chose me. And it was a massive, massive blow to Archie and Martin.
They were
devastated. Archie never played again for Forest.
No.
They were devastated. And a couple of years later, when I plucked up a bit of courage and was brave enough, and I bumped into Brian and I said to him, why did you pick me instead of those two, like, you know? He said, I thought you were less likely to tell me a lie. about being injured. I thought, oh, thanks for that, boss.
Vote of confidence.
Fortunately, Malmo were very well organised, terrific organisation, but a very average team, you know. They never really threatened us. The only chance I had was when Burnsy tried to be clever and made a mistake, and we got away with that one. After we got the goal, we were always going to win the game 1-0. They were very poor attacking-wise, but very well organised. But the game was a bit disappointing. But as I say, that was 71st game of the season. And they made it very difficult for us to play. And we were a bit down, actually, in the dressing room after the game, believe it or not. And I always remember Brian saying, listen, in 12 months' time, nobody will remember how you played. It'll just remember Nottingham Forest European Cup winners. Like, you know? He's right, you know.
I think that's a great place to leave it at the end of the first half. Nottingham Forest European Cup winners, and a big thanks to this man. So recharge your glasses, Frank Clark, everybody. So tell us how you got into management. So it was Leighton Orient originally, although you were assistant manager at Sunderland.
Sunderland was the start. I mean, I played the European Cup final against Malmo, and. I'd had a few injuries that season, and I was coming up 36, you know, so my body was kind of trying to give me a message, you know. But I had another year left on my contract at Forest, and I was quite happy to see that out. I knew I wouldn't be probably in the first 11, but I was quite happy to stay. And then I got a call from a lad called Ken Knighton, who just got the manager's job at Sunderland. I didn't really know Ken very well. I'd met him on a couple of coaching courses, but I didn't know him that well. Anyway, he said he wanted me to go and be the assistant manager up there. And I just thought it all came at the right time, you know. I went to see Brian. He tried to talk me out of it, offered me another year as a player, and said, you know, you won't be in the first 11, but I would like you to stay around the club and help bring the young lads through and all that. Like. But I just thought that it was a great opportunity. I mean, I knew Sunderland as a club. They were then in the second division. And it just seemed like, I always wanted to go into management. It seemed like a great opportunity to start there, you know.
Any regrets at not taking that extra year at Forest?
No, I was, it might have been nice. I might have been on the bench for the second European Cup final, but no, it was the right thing to do.
And then, so what happened then? So leaving.
Well, we got the sack at Sunderland.
Leaving Sunderland in 82. What happened then, between then and Leighton Orient?
Well, I actually came back. Not many people know this. I actually came back to Forest as a reserve team coach. I was on a coach. I lost. Ken and I got sacked at Sunderland in the April, just before the end of the season. Our second season there. And I was on a coaching course in the summer with Ronnie Fenton and Liam O'Kane. Ronnie was then the first team coach here. Liam was the youth coach. And they were talking about looking for a reserve team coach. And I said, I mean, I'd been out of work for 3 months, you know, and you start to worry then, you know. And I said, well, I could fancy that. Well, we never thought you'd be interested in that. Come down and see them. Like. So I came down to see the big two. And the contract they offered me was absolute rubbish. Like. I mean, it was crap. They didn't, you know, Brian was very loyal to his staff, but he didn't pay them very well. But I took the job, I was desperate. So I took the job, and it was the best sort of 2 or 3 months of my whole life. I mean, it was a doddle. I hadn't moved back down here. We were going to move back down here, but I hadn't had it. I was living up in the Northeast. I was staying in the Forest Hills, and when you're in a hotel, you know, you get up early and you go in, you're usually first into the club in the mornings, and I used to bum into Peter Taylor. By then, Peter used to just come into the club early, pick up the racing post and go home. And it was round about the time they were trying to sign Justin Fashanu. And when I was at Sunderland, we had a big rough, tough centre-back called Rob Hindmarch. And we played against Norwich, and he batted Justin all over the place. And Justin had chucked it in. He had chucked it in. And I'm thinking, should I say something? Should I say something to Peter O'Brien? Like, should I? I was trying to plug up the courage. Anyway, I bump into Peter one morning, and I'm thinking, this is it. Like, it's now or never. So I said to Peter, Peter, you know, Justin Fashanu, and I told him the story. He went berserk. Started poking me in the chest. Listen, son, do you want to be a coach? Do you want to be a scout? Well, keep your fucking opinions to yourself. I'm thinking, I'm sorry, Pete, I'm only trying to help. And
I guess the rest is history on that one.
Well, yeah, yeah, exactly, yeah. But yeah, I was running the reserve team. You know what Brian's like with training? 3 or 4 days a week, only in the mornings. I used to try and give them extra training. He would get wind of it, and that would be the end of that, like, you know. I had some really good young players coming through in the reserves. Gary Mills, Sutty was in goals. Fairclough, Chrissy Fairclough, Hodgie, people like that. You know, Colin Walsh. And I had all them playing in my reserve team, because in those days, this business about squads and that didn't exist, you know. The 12 lads went with the first team. The reserves played on a Saturday at the same time, and all the rest played in the reserves, you know. So it was... It was a great job, but the money was rubbish, like, you know. And Ken got the job at Lane Orient, and asked me to go with him again. So, like a fool, I thought, well, that seemed like a good idea. I trebled my wages, thinking that would be, you know, that would be great. And then when I went down there, I found out about house prices. It didn't seem such a good idea.
That's why it was three times the money.
Absolutely.
And 1989 playoff winner. As Forest fans, we're not really into the playoffs, are we? I think it's something that happens after the regular season ends. A few teams get lucky and end up playing in the playoffs.
Yeah, I mean,
was that a Wembley win?
No. Back in those days, there were no Wembley finals. You played a two-legged semi-final that we played against Scarborough, two legs, knocked them out. And then played Wrexham in a two-legged final, home and away. And we drew up there 0-0 and beat them 2-0 in the second leg. And I pulled off probably one of the master strokes of my whole career, if I say so myself. We had a left winger called Alan Comfort. You won't have heard of him. But he was a very, very good player for us. Really good player. He's a preacher now, but he was a good player as well. And he was our key man, like, and the playoff finals were very late then, you know, maybe into June. And Alan, never thinking we'd be in the playoff finals, arranged his wedding on the day of the second leg of the final in Ireland at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I'm thinking, fuck, man, what am I going to do now here? He wouldn't call it off, wouldn't change the arrangements. So I was running the club as well as being the manager. I was running, doing everything. I was on the safety committee. If Alan Bexton was here, he wouldn't be very happy. I managed to persuade the safety committee that we had to kick off for safety's sake at 11:30 on Sunday morning. Because if they got too much drink in them, there'd be a lot of crowd trouble, you know. And the police were delighted with that. Police, nowadays, every game in London on a bank holiday, I think, or a Sunday, has to kick off at 12 o'clock.
Yeah, early kickoffs, yeah.
So I managed to persuade everybody that we had to kick off at 11:30. And I sold the story to the Sunday Express. When I say I sold the story, I gave them the story, and they put on a helicopter. They provided a helicopter to land at this playing field just adjacent to Lane Orient's ground, pick Alan up as soon as the game had ended and fly him out to the city airport so he could catch the 2 o'clock flight to Ireland and get to his wedding.
Brilliant. So I guess the only thing he missed was the celebrations.
He missed the celebration. And we'd have been struggling if it had gone to extra time.
So you were talking there about, you're not just manager, safety officer, you were managing director as well.
Yeah, I mean, my last 2-3 years there, I was managing director. I wasn't really involved with the playing side of things. I brought in a team manager, Peter Eustace, and he ran the football side. I did all the transfers, all the admin, all that kind of thing, and I ran the whole club. And I quite enjoyed that, and I thought that was me for the rest of my career. Like, I was working for a fantastic chairman, a fella called Tony Wood, great man. I always remember it. Leighton Orient was a club, when I was a manager, every month or every 2 months, we were that far from going out of business. Honestly, it was that bad. Like, I remember we started off, I started off my one season, I had 14 players. Me, a physio, the youth coach, and 14 players. And it was desperate money all the time. And I'd been there six or seven years, I think. And it got really bad at the end of this particular season. We were going down. It was all over. And this fella turned up, very unkind of prepossessing sort of fella, and said, "I'd like to buy the club." He was an EastEnder who'd gone to Rwanda. Remember, you know where Rwanda is in Africa, where all the gorillas are? And he'd made a fortune out of coffee. He processed all the coffee beans that came out of Africa and sold them on to Nescafe and all that sort of thing. And he'd made a fortune. He wasn't married. And I was looking to leave by then. I'd had enough. And he said to me, "I want you to stay and run the club." And I said, "Okay, what do you want to do with it?" We're in the fourth division then. He said, "Well, I think we can, I think we eventually could be a second division club, a decent second division club. I'd like us to have a youth scheme." And I said, "Well, that all sounds great, that." I said, "But it'll take a lot of money. These amounts might sound very little now, but it was an awful lot of money back in 1986-7. I said, "It'll cost you 120 grand a year, you personally, if you want to do it right, doing it that way." And he said words that were music to my ears. He said, "That's all right." He said, "The interest on my Swiss bank accounts will cover that." And I thought, "You'll do for me." And he was true to his word. He was the most unassuming bloke. He spent most of his time in Rwanda. When he came across to England, he liked nothing better than going into the club shop and waiting behind the, you know, serving behind the counter and all that sort of thing. Great man. So I was really enjoying it, you know. I had really good staff. And we were doing all right. We were kind of upper reaches of the third division by then. And then out of the blue, Brian leaves here, and I get a call from Fred Reacher, who I knew obviously from my time here as a player. Typical Fred. He said, "Now then, Frank, how are you?" I said, "Yeah, I'm all right, Fred, I'm all right." He said, "You'll have heard Brian's gone." I said, yeah, I saw it in the papers, Fred. I said, "Why?" He said, "Listen, you couldn't help us out." He said, "We've been turned down by four people." He said, "We're desperate. do you want the job?" Well, thank you for that vote of confidence, Fred. That's very kind of you, like, you know. And I couldn't turn it down. I mean, the probably only two jobs I would have taken at that time, that was here or Newcastle, because I was really settled at Forest. And I felt as though I'd let the chairman down there, but I couldn't turn the job down here, you know.
So what do you remember from that initial period? So, I mean, let's talk about size of shoes to fill. We're talking about the best manager that the club,
yeah, no doubt about that,
has ever had and will ever have. And you've got to fill those shoes.
Well, that never worried me, really, trying to fill your shoes. I never tried to be another Brian Clough. Like, that would have been silly. But it was interesting. It didn't really start off in the best way. Fred asked me to come up on this particular day, and they were going to announce my appointment the next day. And it coincided with, I think it was a County Cup match. And it was Brian's last game, if you remember, at the City Ground.
Yeah.
And I stayed at Fred's house, and I had to stay there on my own all night. Well, him and I had came to this game, like, you know. And then I was introduced the next day. And so it didn't start too well.
And I think I'm right in saying a couple of big names were leaving, one being Nigel at the time.
Yeah, listen, the club was in a bit of a state. Like, obviously, they'd been relegated. The Messiah had gone. And people were thinking, oh, my God, like, you know, what's going to happen? There was a whole kind of gloom surrounding the club, you know, that needed dealing with. Like, three international players all wanted to leave.
Roy Keane?
Roy, Nigel, Piercy, four, in fact, Gary Charles. The ticket office manager was in jail. I don't know if you remember that. I don't know whether you remember that. And the older members amongst you will remember a program that used to be on Granada television called World in Action, a bit like a Panorama is now. And they had a team stationed permanently in Nottingham trying to dig up crap on the club. Like. And they used to doorstep the staff. Like. Liam would come in and say, oh, they've been on my bloody doorstep again. Like. So it was difficult. It was a difficult situation. But I just had to get on with it and get it done. Roy was always going to go. There was no chance of keeping Roy. As soon as I saw the clause in his contract, if the club get relegated, which the club had given him this previous season to persuade him to sign a new contract, which I understood, you know, they didn't think they'd get relegated. If the club get relegated, you can leave for $3.5 million and you will get 10% of the fee. So I'm thinking, I'm on stony ground here. Especially as one of the first phone calls I got when I took the job was from Sir Alex, well, then Alex Ferguson, now Sir Alex Ferguson, saying, now then, Frank, congratulations in the job. Now, what about Roy Keane and that clause in his contract? I said, well, you obviously know about it, Alex. Tell your chairman to ring mine, agree to pay the money, and you can speak to him, you know. So that was always going to happen. And Roy was fine with that. I mean, I had him in and I spoke to him and I said, listen, I understand that, but no chance, you know. If you want to come in and train, that's great. You can come in and train with the reserves. Obviously, you're not going to be part of the first team. You know, and he was great. Came in, none of this big time Charlie stuff. Trained with the kids, really put himself about. Got his move to Manchester United. Wrote his autobiography and then accused me of being a twat because I'd made it hard for him to move. I've only got him to the best club in the world where he's won everything, made a fortune, then he slaughtered me in his autobiography. But that was Roy. Nigel was always going to go because of what had happened with his father and one or two of the board members. So Liverpool wanted to take him. I thought Liverpool would be a great move for him. And Fred did the deal with them. I think $2.5 million, I think. Gary Charles came to see me. I'm sure some of you remember Gary Charles had a rough time in the city the previous 2 years. He'd got a drink problem. He'd have trouble with his wife. He'd crashed his car and all that sort of thing. Came to see him and he said, Gaffer, I've got to get out of Nottingham and the East Midlands. And I said, I understand, Gary. That's okay, son. We'll try and get you a deal, get you away. He only went and signed for Derby. But listen, we got 750 grand for him, two and a half for Nige, three for Roy, if you like, and that was money that the board said I could spend. That was the other thing that they told me to cheer me up when I took the job. The first board meeting, they said, now listen, Mr. Manager, we don't want to hear any of this crap about consolidation. You've got to get us straight back into the Premier League. And by the way, there's no money to spend.
Yeah, no pressure.
But if you bring money in, you can spend that. And they were as good as a word, you know. So with that money, I was able to make it look like my team, if you like.
So what happened with the skipper then?
Piercy, I thought, I've lost those two, Nigel and Roy. I've got to try and persuade him to stay, like, you know. He didn't want to leave Stuart, really. He was worried about his England place, which I understood. You know, playing in the first division or the championship now, you know. So I spoke to, I think it was Graham Taylor, was it Terry Venables? Might have been Terry by then, I think. And he said, no, he said, I'll be watching him, and if he's playing if he's playing, if he can't play, he'll still be in the squad, you know. So I was able to reassure him on that. And then I had to negotiate a new contract with him. And I said to Fred, Fred, I don't really want to negotiate contracts. I've been doing that for 10 years. I've been doing everything for 10 years on that. I've got enough on my plate without negotiating contracts. And Fred said, fucking hell, you'll have to. There's nobody else here can do that. Thank you, that's good. So I was having to do it with Stuart and his agent. And it was torturous. It went on forever. He was really hard to deal with. But eventually, he signed. And I have to say, he was a fantastic captain for me.
Fantastic. And so the money that came in got spent?
Yeah, I spoke to the staff, to Alan and Liam and Archie. You know, I had a bit of idea what the team needed. They'd not been able to score goals, had they, previous season. They'd sold Teddy Sheringham, not really replaced him. And they more or less said we could do the centre-back and a striker. They were the pressing positions that they thought. And then they mentioned Collymore, who apparently they'd looked up the previous season and thought about buying but didn't. And I said, oh yeah. Fortunately, I'd seen a lot of Stan in London. When I was at Leighton Orient, I used to go to loads of football combination games, reserve games, all around London. And Stan was in Crystal Palace reserves initially, couldn't get in the first team. So I'd seen a lot of them. And I'd spoken to the chief scout over at Crystal Palace, and he recommended him really strongly. So I knew all about Stan. And the other one they mentioned was Colin Cooper, who was at Millwall. And I'd seen a lot of Colin as well. So I was more than happy to go for those two. And I remember Colin was the first one. We signed him, me and Alan, sitting in the lounge of a hotel in London with a Millwall secretary doing the deal. And it was £1.5 million. And I'd never spent more than £10,000 in my whole managerial career. And this fella walked out and left, like, and the deal was done. And I went, oh, Jesus Christ. And Hilly, which is great, he's great for me, Alan, you know, he's very impetuous, Alan. He tends to do things before he thinks. He says, come on, get on the phone to Vic Jobson at Southend. Let's get Collymore done. I said, hang on a minute, Alan, I'm still trying to come to terms with spending £1.5 million. Now you're asking me to spend another £2 million. Yeah, come on, let's get it done. And fortunately, we got straight on the phone to Vic Jobson, who I knew very well, who was a real villain character. I don't know what you want to call him. But if I can tell you, when he died and they had a minute's silence at Southend, the crowd booed for an hour. He wasn't very popular, but he was a hard man to deal with as well. But anyway, we got the deal done with him. Then we had to get Stan, and Stan was away on holiday with his girlfriend, who lived in Croydon, and he was staying with her parents. So we knew he was coming back on this particular flight, and we were chasing him around Croydon, trying to get hold of him. Before this agent called Ambrose Mendy got hold of him, because Stan didn't have an agent. Obviously, we wanted to get to him before he got an agent, you know. Anyway, we managed to get him, and he was really easy to deal with. He was very naive. And we got him on a sensible contract, and he did okay for us.
Yeah, he was some player, wasn't he? There's a great story about it. It wasn't the best trainer, was he?
No. Well, that's putting it kindly, that, no. No, he wasn't the best. He didn't like training. He used to try and figure out when we'd have a hard session, and he'd somehow be missing. But he was a bit naive, like, you know. He rang in one day, and he said, "I can't come in for training, boss. My grandmother died, and it's a funeral today, like, you know." Well, that's all right. Fucking hell, we're not inhuman. You got the funeral stand, that's lovely. Like. Anyway, Alan Hill, being Alan Hill, he's such a lovely guy. sends a big bunch of flowers to Stan's mother. Right? So about 3 days later, he gets a call from Stan's mother. Alan, those flowers, they were absolutely lovely. But why did you send them? And Alan said, well, we feel, you know, your mother's just died. And she said, my mother died 15 years ago. But you couldn't fall out with him, like, you know. He was a problem all the time, but it was worthwhile because of what he did on a Saturday, like, you know. Sometimes you have to make allowances for really talented players, like, you know. And it took me a long time in my career to realize this. I always had this silly fucking socialist idea that you had to treat everybody the same, like, you know, it didn't matter who you were. Well, that's crazy in a football club, you know, because it'd be the easiest thing in the world for me to sell Colly Moore and get rid of his problems. Well, it makes you worse. If you're weak in your team, why are you doing that, like, you know? So I used to, what I did, I had a great group of players in the dressing room, senior players, Pierce, Cooper, Chettle, and I could trust them, like, you know. And I used to bring them in and say, listen, Stan's been at it again. I'm thinking of finding him, but I might not. And they would say, no, don't find him. Fucking don't find him, boss. The lads are all right. We know what he's like. We're all right. He'll win us a game on Saturday, you know. And that's how we did it for 2 years, you know.
He was something special, wasn't he? It must have been great as a manager to know that you've
The most talented player I've ever worked with. Talented, but not the best footballer, because there were things missing, like, you know.
Yeah.
He didn't want it badly enough. He should have had a cupboard full of caps, like, you know.
Yeah, two England caps is wrong, isn't it?
He could do everything. I mean, he didn't like training, but he was a great athlete. Fantastic build, 6'4", not an ounce of fat on him. Could win it in the air, could smash it with either foot from 30 yards, could get tap-ins, could run past people. He was amazing, but he didn't want it badly enough. I'll tell you, this kind of sums him up, really. At the end of the second season, this is before he left, if you remember, England played Brazil and Japan in a three-team tournament at Wembley as a rehearsal for Euro 96. And four of our players got picked for that squad. PSE, obviously, Colin Cooper, Steve Stone, and Stan. All got picked. Fantastic honour for the club, that, like, and for the boys, you know. And so off they went. Terry Venables was the manager. And they were together for about 2 weeks. And about halfway through, I got a call from Terry. Frank, he says, tell me about Colly Moore. Tell me about... I said, well, why, Terry? What's the matter? He says, well, like, he comes to train and he doesn't look as though he wants to be there. He doesn't want to be there. He just got into the England squad. Like, 3 years previously, he was at Stafford Rangers, like, you know. You'd think he'd be absolutely... And he just... I saw him quite a few years after. Like, he's smashing. I've got a good relationship with him now. And I said to him, Stan, you know, you had more talent in your big toe, like, than I had. But you ain't got a medal. You got one cap. Don't you regret it? He said, but I've got a million in the bank.
Yeah, sums it up, doesn't it, unfortunately.
Such a shame, like, you know.
Yeah, yeah. So you were tasked with getting Forest back into the Premier League, which happened.
Yeah, but it was a struggle.
It was. Remember it well.
October, I think we were in about 6th or 7th from bottom. We'd had a few injuries. Colly Moore had been injured. I think Piercy got injured. We were short of bodies, really, in the squad. And then in October, I think it was October, I was able to sign Lars Bohinen. And he was like the last piece in the jigsaw for that team, because that enabled me to move Steve Stone out wide on the right and play David Phillips as a holding midfield player. We went to Birmingham away Lars' first game, we beat them 3-1, murdered them. And we took off from there.
Yeah, Lars was some player as well, wasn't he?
Yeah, greedy bastard, but good player. Good player.
And then, good player. So fast forward to the following season, we're back in the Premier League. What a season that was. The chance of there's only one team in Europe, quarterfinals of the UEFA Cup. Great times.
Yeah, that was the third season, you mean?
The first season back in the Premier League, after promotion.
Weren't in Europe in the first season back.
Finished third.
We finished third in that first season, which was amazing, really. We just hit on a, you know, we were very lucky with injuries. We hardly got an injury all season, and that makes a difference. I was able to sign Brian Roy in the summer. He made a difference. There's a story there if you want to hear it. We got promoted, and I said to Fred, have I got some money to spend? You know, we need a bit of quality in the team if we're going to go in the Premier League. Nah, sorry, no money. The board said no money to spend. So I'm thinking, oh, great. Like. Anyway, I get a phone call during the summer from an agent who I knew, and he says, what are you looking for? I said, well, we ain't got no money, really. I said, I'd like to bring in an attacking left-sided player, but we got no money. He says, what, you mean someone like Brian Roy, who at that time was playing in the Dutch World Cup team in America? And I said, don't take the mickey, like, you know. I said, yeah, but I'm going to get him. He said, well, you could. He said, he's been playing for Foggia in Italy. They've just been relegated. They're desperate for cash, and he's the only thing they've got, player they've got to sell. And you can get him for $2 million. All right, so I went to Fred. I told him, I gave him the story. He said, listen, just keep it between you and me. I won't tell the rest of the board. Run with it and see where it leads you, like, you know. So we did. We agreed a fee with Fodger. And as I say, Brian was in America playing in the World Cup. And this agent had a bit of a relationship with Brian's agent. He wasn't Brian's agent, but he had a relationship with him. And he said, the agent has been able to persuade the Dutch manager to let Brian come out of the camp in America if you're prepared to fly across it, you know, come and meet you in Miami or somewhere like that. So, right, I'm off. So I jump on the plane, fly to Miami, get off the plane. The agent's waiting for me. He said, I've got good news and bad news. I said, well, what's the bad news? He said, the manager's changed his mind. He won't let him come out and meet you. I'm thinking, Christ, I've come all this way. I can't get to see him. What a waste of time. He says, what's the good news? I've got your seat on the Dutch official's coach to the game tonight, and you can go and watch the game. So I thought, well, what have I got to lose? Like, I may as well, I wasn't flying back, you know, my flight wasn't back the next day, so I'm going to get on the coach, and he said, the only thing is, he said, you've got to keep your head down, get up the back, and sit amongst the wives. The players' wives were at the back, and all the official Dutch officials were at the front. So I go up to the back, and who do I sit next to? Brian's wife, who's an aspiring actress. So I get chatting to her, like, you know, I'm keep my head, I'm chatting to her, like, and she said, how far is London from Nottingham? And I'm thinking, I said, about half an hour. Oh, she said, that's all right. She said, I thought I was miles away. So anyway, we agree that he's going to sign. And the day he's coming across to sign, we've got a board meeting. And the agent leaks the story to the press that Brian Roy is coming to sign for Nottingham Forest. I'm furious. But you can imagine the rest of the board are even more furious because they don't know anything about it. So I go in this boardroom and I get absolutely hammered, like, you know. I said, listen, it's Brian Roy. I said, he's playing in the World Cup for Holland. Can't you see what that's going to do for us as a club and you know, as a team? You know, the supporters will think, oh, like they're standing, you know. And we went round and round the table in the boardroom. Initially, it was only me and Fred were saying yes. All the rest were saying, oh, we can't afford it, we can't afford it. After about an hour, we managed to persuade them all that we had to do it. We had to do it. And he signed for us.
I guess the rest is history with Brian Roy, isn't it? What a player.
Yeah, well, him and Stan were fantastic together.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm conscious of time. So let's... And I want to talk a little bit about now and when you were chairman. So Manchester City. So let's leave the
well, Manchester City won't take long. was a nightmare. I shouldn't have gone there. My last 4 or 5 months here were difficult, really difficult for me. I don't know if you remember, there was all the takeover stuff, talk swirling around. We were struggling a little bit to win games, and I just thought the board had lost faith in me, like, you know, and they were stopped me managing the club, and they were using the prospective takeover as an excuse, and I had a real hard time, and eventually I went to them. I said, look, either back me or sack me. By this time the chairmanship had changed, and Irving Corn was chairman. That's how it was. Like, after 3 years, the next one who was in turn got the job, like, and Irving was a nightmare, like, you know. I used to come in every day and say, oh, we've got to sell somebody. The bank's been on. We've got to get the overdraft down. You've got to sell somebody. All right, I can sell Piercy. I can sell Stoney. Colin Cooper. Oh no, you can't sell. They can't sell them. The crowd will go berserk. I'm saying, well, who do you want me to sell? Nobody's going to buy our reserves, like, you know. And that's how it was. The Bosman ruling had come into football and made them very, very nervous at Forest, because no director at Forest ever put any money in, ever, which was understandable, because the way it was run then, they could get voted out on a whim, as Derek Pavis found out, you know. So it was a nightmare. So I resigned. They wouldn't back me, and I should have had 6 months off. Like, I was battered a bit, like, you know. For, it was the first time in my whole managerial career that I wasn't sleeping at night. Like, I'd always been able to deal with it, even in the depths at Orient, when we were that far from going out of business, I could rationalise it, you know. But I found it very difficult to deal with that. And Manchester City came, and I thought, well, this is great. Like, they're going to pay me twice as much as I was on at Forest, even though they're in the championship or whatever it was. And, you know, Francis Lee, ex-player, he's got to be a great chairman. Some you win, some you lose. It was a nightmare. I knew the day I got there. I said to them, I want everybody dealt with before I get there. I'm not coming in and sucking anybody. If you want people out, I want it done before I get there. So I go up the night before I'm going to take the job, stay in this hotel, and the vice chairman comes to pick me up, David Bernstein, later to be the chairman of the FA, picks me up, takes me to the training ground, and it's a massive car park at the training ground. And he takes me, fucking hell, right up to the far corner. And he's gone. We sat in the far corner, and I'm thinking, aye, aye, what's happening here? Like, I said, David, what? Why are we here? Oh, he said, we've got to stay here, because Phil Neal, who was the acting manager, he's still in there saying his goodbyes and clearing his desk. And I'm sat hiding in the fucking corner of a car park. And that summed it up. And it was like that the whole time. And I found out about getting sacked on the radio. That's how good they were up there, like, you know. Horrible. So that's short and sweet.
Yeah,
not
yeah,
very
there
sweet.
We go. That's enough for Manchester City, isn't it? Yeah, that's enough. So then the chairmanship. So let's move forward to Fawaz, and you then coming along. Somebody laughing.
Do we have to move forward to Fawaz? No, it was before Fawaz.
Nigel.
Nigel.
Yeah, yeah.
If you remember, Nigel Doughty appointed Steve McLaren.
Yeah.
And he thought he'd found the perfect manager for the club, like, you know. But he was wrong. Steve had been out of the domestic game for 5 years. He'd been England coach. He'd been England manager. He'd coached in Holland and spoke Dutch very well. And he'd forgotten how intense English football was. And I don't know whether you can remember, I used to come and watch them in those days. When they had the ball, they looked a really good team. Fucking hell, when they didn't have it, team were just running over them, running through them. And I remember and Nigel was getting some terrible stick on social media. This is a man who's put £80 million of his own money in the football club. And he is getting dog's abuse on social media. Excuse me. And he couldn't stay off it. And I remember the day it all happened. Birmingham City at home. You probably remember the game.
Yeah, I do.
We lost 4-0, 4-1.
I think it was 3-1. I think.
Well,
I think they scored three goals in the last 10 minutes.
We were shocking.
1-0 up, but it was
we were shocking.
Yeah.
I think we went to the bottom of the league, or second bottom. And McLaren walked out. And fair dues to him, he walked away from his contract. Never took a penny. He also left four people that he brought in on an unbelievable contract that we couldn't get rid of, but never mind. So he walked out, and Nigel said, I'm resigning from the chairmanship. I don't want to be in the firing line anymore. I'll still finance the club to the level that I have been doing, but I don't want to be the chairman. So he rang me and he said, I'd like you to come in as a consultant to the club. And I thought, well, I'll have a bit of that, like. Consultant, that's the best job in the world, isn't it? Fucking hell, you go in, you give your opinion, and you get out, and if it doesn't work, you're not there, you're all right, and you get paid for it. So I was up for that. But a day later, he rang me again. And again, I guess, talk about making you feel good. He said, things have changed a bit. He said, the bloke I had in mind to be the chairman has bottled it out. He doesn't want it. Will you take it? I won't tell you who it was, the bloke. He's a nice bloke, but he realised that he wasn't cut out for it. So he asked me to come in and be the chairman. And I was happy to do it. You know, I had authority to do hire and fire, whatever I wanted, but it all had to be within the confines of the budget that was at the club then, which meant that you couldn't sign a player unless you sold a player. Mark Arthur had just appointed Steve Cottrell the day before, which could have put me in a very an embarrassing situation because he didn't tell me. And the morning before I took the chairman's job, I had a meeting with I can't tell you who he was, but he was a very well-known ex-Nottingham Forest player, a very good manager who was out of work, and I asked him if he wanted the job. Fortunately, he turned it down because they'd already given it to Cottrell, but they didn't tell me. Anyway, and off we went. It was very difficult. I told Cottrell, I told all his supporters, I'm never one for flannel. When I came in, there is no money to spend. So don't be chanting, we should be signing this one, that one. We ain't got any money. We're going to have to get on with what we've got. And we were struggling. We were struggling. We were a poor team, like, you know. Poor, poor team. And Wes Morgan, big Wes, centre-back, smashing lad, top lad. Not many people at Nottingham Forest thought he was very good, like, believe it or not. And his contract had been allowed by the club to run down over a number of years to the point where he'd seen players come in who weren't putting anywhere near as much as him in on twice of his wages, maybe three times his wages. And he was disillusioned with that. And so I went to him and I said, look, I want you to stay, like, I'll get you a new contract when I can. No, I'm going. Don't waste your time, like. This was October, November. But he carried on playing. I knew Leicester fancied him. And at the end of the season, they could have taken him for a free. That's, you know, his contract would run out. And anyway, Leicester came and paid £1 million for him in the January window, which was a lifeline to us, an absolute lifeline. Because we gave that to Steve Cottrell and enabled him to bring in four players on loan. So that money was to pay the wages, not to pay any fees, just to pay the wages. And he brought in four players, Danny Higginbottom, Guardiola, remember Guardiola? Two more, who I can't remember, George Alicorby from Wolves. Anyway, four players who made us a better team. Like.
Yeah.
And so we were all right. And then Chelsea came in to sign Bamford, Patrick Bamford. It was another one who'd been allowed to get in a contract situation which was poor, you know, because his contract was running out at the end of the season. He couldn't have walked away for nothing, but we wouldn't have got much for him at a tribunal because he was just a kid, like, you know. Anyway, I had a few ups and downs. I don't know if anybody in here knows this, Patrick's father. Do you? But I had a few ups and up and downs with him, like. He wanted to take him all around the country to Premier League clubs to have a look at their facilities. I said, no, you ain't doing that, like, you know. If he signs a new contract, because I know you want to get him out, like, if he signs a new contract, you can take him. And he can go on loan to these clubs. If he signs a new contract, if he doesn't, he ain't going anywhere. And it got quite heated with his father and his agent. Anyway, I'll try and cut this short. We got a phone call from Chelsea. Patrick Bamford will give you £500,000, now and £500,000. I said, that's not, no, we're not into that line. But a week later, came back again. We'll give you £1 million up front, posh. Well, we had to look at that, you know. We had to look at that. So I said to Patrick, look, they've offered £1 million for you. You want to go down and talk to them? Go and talk to them, but come back to us and give us a chance, like, you know. Anyway, off he went down to Chelsea and signed. And I said, Patrick, you know, I asked you to come back. Well, he said, they've offered me a 5-year contract, £7,000 a week. £7,000 a week. 18 years of age, 5 years.
He's not going to say no to that, is he?
Couldn't compete with that.
Yeah.
But we got the £1 million, and we thought we'll keep that for a rainy day, like, because the window was closed in anyway. And then the real tragedy, Nigel died in February. Tragedy for him, obviously, and his family. Big tragedy for the club. We thought we had a cast iron system with his people, where at the end of each month, John Pelling sent them a financial statement, and they covered the loss. Because we were losing about £2 million a month. 15, one and a half, £2 million a month. And, you haven't got that. No, that's not right. Is the estate aren't going to do that, lad. So this bloke who was acting for the estate, the solicitor, used to come up on the train, come into the boardroom, and we used to try and explain to him the ramifications, like, you know. If we don't get the money, the club will go into if not into liquidation, into administration. Because we're not going to trade illegally. I mean, John Pelling is the straightest bloke I've ever met in my life. And there's no way I didn't want to be involved either. There's no way he would have allowed the club to trade illegally. Like. And this bloke would say, oh, all right then, okay. He'd get on the train. When he got off at St. Pancras, he'd fucking change his mind again, like, you know. And it was never ending, that. It was never ending. We had three young players who had all earned a contract, a pro contract. They'd done their apprenticeship, came to the last year, 18 years of age. If you think they've got a chance, you should give them a contract as a pro. So they can be a pro and see if they can, you know, prosper. And these three lads were outstanding. Jack Blake, Ben Osborne, and an Irish boy called David. I just can't remember his surname. My memory's awful for names at the minute. And these three lads deserved a contract. Not a lot of money. £150 a week, something like that. And this bloke said, no, you can't do that, lad. So I spoke to John and Mark. I said, I'm going to do it. If we don't do this, this will destroy our academy. Because everybody else in the academy knew these lads deserved a contract. So it wasn't just them three. It was the effect it would have on everybody else. And so we did it. Ben, obviously, to be fair, Ben was the least of the three that we thought would make it. But he's the only one of them who has made it, like, you know. So we did that, and we managed to get through, survived by the skin of our teeth, and then the club was sold to the Al-Hassawis. And that was the end of my role as chairman, because they wanted their own people in, like, which is, that was fair enough, like.
Yeah. Well, let's finish off by bringing it up to date, Frank, and talk a little bit.
Yeah, sorry, I'm
That's all right. It's absolutely fine. It's fascinating to listen to those times. It's still a bit raw, isn't it? Last season, what happened?
Don't remind me. I can't explain it. I was with some of the lads today at a signing session, and Archie and Viv got hold of me and said, "What happened? How did it happen?" I said, "I fucking don't know. I really don't know." The game against Stoke. I mean, it should have been all over before Stoke. We should never have had to get anything from that game. You know, we threw points away all over the place. The game against Stoke was probably our best, for an hour, was our best home performance since we beat Leeds. They played really well. They were positive. And when it came to the second drinks break, 62 minutes, 63 minutes, whatever, it was 1-1, and we were controlling the game. We were comfortable. Stoke were all right. They weren't, you know, they had nothing to play for. They were safe. We were okay. And then after we went back on, I don't know what happened, honestly. We just fell apart. We fell apart. And then with a minute to go on both games, we were still all right. We were losing 3-1. Swansea were winning 3-1.
Yeah,
that was all right. We stayed in the playoffs.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Routledge, who's never scored a bloody header in his life, a little shit, headed a goal for Swansea in the 92nd minute. That meant, and ever so funny, Yanis came rushing down from the box, shouting to Sabri, "We've got to get a goal, we've got to get another goal." And of course, everybody went up for a free kick. And they got a breakaway goal, which by then didn't matter, like, you know. But I cannot explain why it just fell apart. I really don't know.
Yeah, but like you say, there were enough chances prior to that Stoke game, weren't there, where it should have been? It should have been put to bed. Could have been put to bed.
Oh, it should have been. Yeah. Like, I don't know what it was really. We lost so many points in the last few minutes of a game that I find it hard to explain how it kept happening. And of course, the Derby one, and Joe would be the first to hold his hand up with a silly mistake by Joe Worrell, you know. I don't know what he was thinking about, because the ball had gone through, and Bryce Samba was just going to come pick it up. The kid who was chasing it was miles away. He had no chance of getting there. And Joe, I don't know what he thought, he stepped across him, if you remember. Free kick, into the box, Bryce drops it, boff, 2 points gone. All over, like, you know.
So what about, let's not dwell on last season. What about optimism for next season? Three strong signings ahead of next year?
Yeah, they've signed players who know the English game, which is a good sign. I thought Sabri did a good job as a manager up to a point last season. You can only really judge a manager, but is he getting the maximum out of the players he's got? Has he got them added? And for most of the season, he had. He had a way of playing that some people don't like, but it was very effective. A counter-attacking style, which upset a lot of people at home, and I understand that. It's very difficult to be a counter-attacking style at home, because your crowd expect you to take the initiative and dominate the game. And we never did that, except for Stoke, really. If you look at the statistics, and I'm not a great believer in statistics, there's only one statistic that matters, how many you score and how many they score. But I don't think we hardly ever played a game where we had the majority of possession. So that's how we used to play, on the counter-attack. And that's all right, a way of playing. That's okay if you've got the players for it. I just think we ran out of steam in the after the lockdown.
The games, it was two a week, wasn't it? Well, three a week. Saturday, Tuesday. Yeah. But it was the same for everybody.
Oh, yeah. But I don't think we had a very good transfer window in January. And Sabri was left with not enough players, really. Or not enough players of quality that he needed. And, it was a nightmare.
I'm not going to ask you for
When you look at it, we beat Fulham. We beat Brentford twice. We beat Leeds.
And I think West Brom were the only ones of the top six that we didn't.
Right. I still lie awake worrying about it.
I'm not going to finish on expecting you to give us a prediction for next season. But is there a reason for everybody in this room to be optimistic?
Well,
I think that's no.
Listen, it's difficult to be optimistic in the current situation, not because of what's happened at the club. I think we've got a decent squad. It's better than last season. But like Mr. Marinakis he's trying to keep two clubs in business. You know, it's desperate stuff. With not having any supporters in there, we're about 35% down on revenue, and we're already losing money every month. I'm sure Olympiacos will be the same. It's very, very difficult. I know that there have been some economies made in the administration. I'm glad to hear you've still got your job.
Thank you.
I haven't got mine. I've been sacked. I haven't been sacked. I've been made redundant, really, as an ambassador. But I understand that. I'm a luxury they can't afford at the minute. I'm not doing anything. I mean, the only time I work, really, is when there's hospitality on a match day or when there's sponsors to smooth over and talk to and the fans are about on a match day. That's not happening. So, you know, if they're going to keep me on and carry it, they're paying me for nothing, really. So, I mean, I understand. I'm okay with that. Like, it's not a problem for me. But I think they'll be looking to make economies of scale elsewhere. Although, you know, we've sacked four coaches and brought four new ones in, which I thought was very interesting. I don't know any of them. Do you?
No, but let's move on and let's finish with a Brian Clough story. I don't want to put you on the spot, but let's finish with your favourite Clough story.
I'd rather tell you a George Best story.
Shall we have a George Best story?
Would you like a George Best story?
A George Best story.
George Best, the second best player I ever played against. Pelé was the best, but that's another story. We haven't got time for it. But Bessie was a great player. Anyway, I'm at Newcastle and we're in London one weekend and we play on a Saturday and we've got another game on the Tuesday, so we stay down. So me and Willie McFall fancy a night out in London. And Willie knows Bestie because he's played the Irish team with him. And he said, Bestie will be in Stringfellas. Let's go to Stringfellas and have a drink with George. Oh, that'll do for me, like. So off he goes into Stringfellas. There's George sat at his own table, right next to the ladies' toilet. George, so we sit down, we're having a drink. After about an hour, who comes out of the ladies? Mary Staven, Miss World. Oh. And she walks across towards us, and she walks past George, right up to me. And I'm thinking, fucking hell, that'll do for me, like. And she says, would you like to dance? And I'm saying, oh, Bestie, I've done you, son. She said, would you like to dance? I said, I'd love to. She said, well, fuck off on the dance floor so I can sit next to George.
That's a better note to leave it on, isn't it? Ladies and gentlemen, Frank Clark.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks.
Just before we go, we've got a birthday in tonight, and I forgot. It's on my notes from earlier.
Amy Truck, where is she? Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Amy. Happy birthday, everyone. Give Amy a round of applause,
everyone.
That's
been a good one.
Guys, I hope you've all enjoyed it. Don't forget, we've got our big Forest quiz on Friday the 11th of September. Tickets on sale now, £20 a team, for a team of four. All donations, all proceeds from the tickets to Blooming Dementia and Motor Neurone Disease. And Dave Bassett is coming on Thursday the 22nd of October. Make sure you've got your tickets for that. Once more, please put your hands together for the legend that is Mr. Frank Clark, everybody.